cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Forgive us of our sins. May your Holy Spirit take control of this our lesson, our thoughts, that we all be in sync, studying and understanding your word. For we ask it in Christ's name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Pastor Josiah, I wonder if I can put you on the spot so we can kind of get this out the way. It's in the lesson, not too far away. Is it all right to borrow? Quick answer. We're coming. Go ahead, Pastor. Is it all right to borrow? Or is it right to borrow?
It depends on the situation. But overall, from what we have studied, it's not as all right as some people may be glad to think, because the Bible says that you should not.
Okay, good enough.
But we know that there are exceptions.
Okay, yeah. All right, it says here, this text passage just said in the book of Proverbs, very powerful text. It said, the rich ruleth over the poor, and the borrower is a servant to the lender. Now, that's a text that it is very true. Now, we can't beat around the bush, whether we are Christian or not. When you borrow, you're a servant to the person who lends you the money. Can you imagine that, Pastor Josiah? The folks would, and if you come late, Pastor Josiah, they will tell you, some of them will send you a bill in the mail. Listen, we're here to inform you that your bill has not been paid. They say it in a nice way, but they mean, what they actually mean, come and pay your bill. So, this is a good week lesson, and I just want to read one thing here. It says here on the Sabbath afternoon, it said, one definition of debt is living today on what you expect to earn in the future. Today's debt seems to be a way of life, but it should not be the norm for Christians. The Bible discourages debt. In the scripture, there are at least 26 references to debt, and all are negative. The Bible does not say that it is a sin to borrow money. But it does talk about the often bad consequences of doing so. When considering financial obligation, Paul counseled, render therefore to all their due, taxes to whom taxes are due, custom to whom customs, to fear to whom fear, honor to honor to whom honor. Owe no one anything except to love one another. I take that text very seriously also, Pastor Josiah. But well, I want to stay in this context while taking it seriously.
Yes. First of all, I want to ask our listening audience, virtual here, online, to be open to this subject. When we speak of practicality, there is hardly a Sabbath school lesson that I recall for the past year that is more practical than this one.
Uh-huh.
It is very important. And I want to appeal, if I may, from now, that those of us who are privy to have this information, especially that which we have gone through this week, that we be willing, ready, and open to help others.
Yes, yes.
It is such a vital lesson, is such a vital theme that we're discussing now, that people's physical lives, emotional lives, financial lives depend on our understanding and practicing this. Debt is terrible, and that's putting it very mildly.
Oh my.
When you are in debt, somebody owns part of you.
Oh my.
And we got to be extremely careful how we deal with it. You asked me just now to clarify something. What was that?
On the debt issue?
The debt issue. The debt issue. Death is a problem.
It is, huh?
I mentioned that before. It can upset your life. It can It can take your sleep away.
Yes, yes, yes.
It can take your peace away.
Your confidence also.
It can take your relationship away.
Yeah.
And from what the Bible says, we ought to avoid it.
All right, my last point here in this area. Pastor just said, I remember when I built my house, I owe a guy, I think must be $2,000. I didn't pay him right away. But every time I would see that guy, I would try to hide it. You understand, Pastor Joseph?
Yes.
And the point is, I did not have the money to pay him. Understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that doesn't give you good confidence. And a matter of fact, it makes you not confident at all. And every time I would see his car, I would hide. But praise the Lord, I did pay him off.
Yes. And again, I want to say that even though the Lord, because of his kindness and mercy, brought you through that.
Yes.
I hope it was the first and last time that you'll have a situation like that to deal with. And those of us who are listening here would know that you don't have to experience that which Brother Brown experienced. If you study this lesson well, you don't have to get there at all. You don't hide from people when you owe them. You should go to them. After you've gone to God and ask him to help you with the problem. But if in building your house you went to God first and read what he says about debt, you would have been able to acquire the means, because before you build a house, it had to come to cost.
But the problem is I wasn't a believer, you know.
Oh, you weren't a believer, so you were ignorant then. Ah, that's one of the reasons why we get into debt too. And we're going to meet it here.
Okay.
Right?
All right.
So you have learned your lesson.
Oh, yes.
And I know that you will never have that experience again. I pray you would not.
Pray the Lord.
And you have to pray for yourself too.
That's right. That's
all right. Good.
All right.
Now, you want me to get into Sunday section?
Yes, yes.
Sunday section speaks of the debt problems. And we have the audience before us here. You know that there are many problems. I mentioned a while ago there, the relational problem and the emotional problem and the financial problems that you can get into, the mental problems that you can get into. God wants us to be above and not below. As nations, as countries, families, as individuals, we must be above. God's desire for us is that we be successful. And that's what Deuteronomy speaks about. Deuteronomy 28, that's the very first text mentioned there in Sunday section. He wants us to be above, but never to be beneath. And if we hark back to the memory verse that we're going to get into on Tuesday section, you must keep in mind that if you are borrowing, you're going to be a slave to the rich. That's putting it mildly.
Right.
If you have any counter thought, then please bring it on the floor. But if you are a borrower, you are setting yourself up to be a slave to the rich. Because the rich knows and they study how to catch you.
Yes.
You watch those television ads. Mm. And they're calling you to borrow. And they'll tell you, listen, your first payment will be 2 months from now, 3 months from now, 6 months from now. And you think that it's a good thing. And you bite the bait.
Mercy.
And you get hooked. So that we must be careful, because there are problems in there. There are many problems. Let me just quickly go through them here, and then you can always discuss them here. The first one is ignorance. Ignorance causes us to be in debt. That situation that we should run from. Ignorance is one. Number two, greed. 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 Financial difficulties come to us because of greed and selfishness. Number three, it's very simple. Illness. Mm. Illness can cause us to be in problems.
Yes.
And we should Be very careful not to get into these situations that we have just mentioned here this morning. Any hand?
Yes,
any what is the problem?
Sister Daniel.
Yes. Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. I'm going to share something. I agree with what the scripture says. But we live in a society where debt gets you everything. Because the more debt you have is the better credit score you have.
Right.
Now, as you are aware, we come from Antigua. And my husband says, I don't want any credit card. I'm going to buy everything I need with what money I have.
Right.
Well, what ended up happening is one day we went looking for a car. I used to have credit cards. And when he saw a car that he liked, right here in St. Croix, and they ran his credit, and they said, sir, we're sorry, you don't have any credit. They said, is there anybody else who has credit?
Yes.
He says, okay, run my wife and see what happens. But
right.
I have the credit.
Uh-huh.
Okay? But we didn't actually buy the car.
Right.
But, you know, just to say, we're living in a society where credit gets you everything.
Right.
If you have good credit, you can get a house, you can get a car, you can get a donkey, anything you want. Okay? So it sort of counteracts what we're hearing the scripture is actually saying is, how do we function that way?
Right.
How do we function saying we're just going to spend what we have, we're not going to run up any credits or anything like that, and still survive?
Mm. All right.
That's the question. Mm.
I am going to allow the audience to answer that, but I want to keep in mind that we're going to meet with credit cards later on in this lesson.
Yes.
And the advice, if I recall correctly, the advice here in the Sabbath school lesson, no, I'm just telling you what the lesson says, is to cut them up. Oh, all right, no, yes, I know, it says, yes, and I'm aware of that too, because by the grace of God, I have good credit scores, and I know what it can bring me. But with all that the credit card people say, I am still very cautious, and don't let them, anyway. I wonder if anybody has.
Yes, I do. You know, I know that we should avoid debt as much as we can.
Yes.
But I also am aware that a person who is going to build a house, a person just out of college and has to build a house, if he waits for 20 years to save the house, the price of the house increases. And therefore, what I think the lesson is saying, be prudent in what you do. Let me make my own personal. I use credit card. I love credit card, but I pay credit cards off every month.
Amen.
And if you pay those cards off every month, there is no interest that accrues, and it gives you 2 months to pay. So I do love credit cards, but I manage it with absolute care.
Amen.
Now let me say one thing else. I learned this when I bought a house in Michigan. I learned when I went and discovered sitting to sign that in repaying my debt, when I saw the amortization schedule, for the first half of the loan, you're paying interest, not principal. But the gentleman said something to me that allowed me and my wife to pay off a 30-year mortgage in 12 years. What did he say? He said, if every month you pay what they ask you to pay, and you pay an extra principal, you are wiped off the entire interest on the other side. And I discovered that was true. And I therefore went and found every avenue I could to pay on that principal. And guess what? For the first half of the loan, the principal is so low and the interest is so high. So that the more you can pump into that principal, is the more you pay that loan off. So I am saying some persons may need to get loan because may not all have the means, but find a way, as the lesson suggested, to pay it off as much as you can, so you can take yourself out of that situation as quickly as you can.
I must say here that that's a very good bit of advice that he got from the gentleman. And that is true.
Right.
I know about that myself. I've had that experience. But you see, when I speak to a congregation like this, I am keeping in mind that there are individuals in here who may not have that financial strength to do that. So I don't want us to think that we are here saying it is okay. Brother Dr. Tobias mentioned that you got to be still very cautious, and it's true. You can pay a 30-year mortgage in far less time by paying on the principal extra. That's it, extra every month. That's the key. Now, to make this, I want to clarify something here. I don't think that we are coming over as the lesson is saying that you should not be in debt at all. We're not saying that. There is a thing called planned debt. I wish we had time to go into that. If you don't know it, brothers and sisters, call upon your pastor. Call upon your friends who know how to deal with finance.
All right.
Call upon family members. There is a planned debt scenario that you can learn. I don't want any of the jump into debt without knowing how you're going to come out of it.
Okay. Mr. Herman says here, then we have Pastor Isdale.
I am a widow. About 5 or 6 years ago, I stripped the roof of my house. And with the help of God, I'd never asked one of my children to go sign for me. Nobody. I went to the bank. I took $15,000. On my social, I asked them how much they will deduct. They tell me 100 and change. I say no. I say, if I'm getting 6, take 3 cut of it. And let me tell you, when I finished to pay my loan, I couldn't believe it.
Right.
And I took an insurance. If anything happened to me, if anything happened to me, the insurance will finish to pay for it.
Thank you.
Okay,
all right, thank you. Pastor Esdale is back there.
Yeah. I love the lesson study because it teaches us a lesson. Some of us like to take up more than what we could carry.
Right.
And I'm saying, if you know you're not working, leave the people money alone. Wait until you're working so you could pay it back.
That's good.
Don't read the lesson study.
Yeah.
Because you know you ain't working. Why borrow the money? And then you're going to have to ask Tom, Dick, and Harry to help you. That is when we're talking about greed. And you could be greedy, but when you're too greedy, it's bad. I'm saying, if you are not working, leave the money. And we must learn to study the lesson and cut and contrive and be what we are supposed to be. And don't overdo.
Somebody got it. That's a good point.
But understand, we can also be working healthy and strong and fall down.
Yes.
So you're not going to take that into consideration. Let's have Pastor there.
Yes. I just want to add to what Dr. Tobias added. In that another way, because credit card is the quickest and easiest way to build up your credit. But it's also the quickest and easiest way to destroy it. So one suggestion is you can use a credit card if you already have the money on the account to use a credit card and then pay it off immediately to build your credit.
Right.
Now, I'm one who doesn't use credit cards. So there might be individuals who do not use credit cards. And the reason why, I don't want to get myself in any problems. Praise the Lord. Some of us might not be strong enough to have credit cards.
Right.
But one suggestion, because I ran into the same problem that Sister Daniel ran into. I didn't have any debt, and I went to purchase a car one time, and it let me know I don't have credit history. So one advice that was given, and I think I could share it here, is that you take a small loan and you pay off on that small loan, and by doing that, you build your credit.
Amen.
You don't take that small loan to use it.
No.
You only take that small loan to build
credit.
Your credit.
Yeah.
So as you will need later on to make take a mortgage or car loan, then you'll be able to have credit to do so.
All right.
I hope you're learning. I hope you're learning from all these contributions that are being made. And I want you to
One thing keep in mind I need to add, there is nothing wrong with credit card. No, we're not saying that.
Yeah.
But understanding, it seems like in this age, you have to have a credit card. I went to the airport to pay for a ticket.
Yeah.
You know, passenger said they wouldn't take the cash?
Yes, I know that. I know that.
They will not take the cash.
I know that. Mm-hmm.
You want a credit card?
Yes.
No. Passenger said, I think the time is kind of winding up.
Yes.
Do you know that your brethren or your family members could cause you to go in debt if you're not careful?
Yes, yes.
I remember, Pastor Jesse, that one of my brother, I have several, so you won't know which one. One of them needed a loan. So he asked me to go co-sign for him.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not an Adventist, I'm not a Christian, I'm nothing. So I said to myself, well, this guy must be crazy. Uh-huh. But to help him out, I did not co-sign. I become the surety. Okay. That's the word.
Yes.
I take the loan myself.
Okay.
So that I am responsible for that loan.
Yeah.
You see, money have a way of causing problem, you know. I don't know if you understand that. Money has a way of causing problem. I remember, you see, you hear the bell, Pastor Josiah? I remember, Pastor Josiah, and we're going to speed it up. I had, the hurricane came, 1989. My house get blown away. And you know, the crooked insurance went under. Now I still have a loan with Bank of Popular. And whatever, the government get together and they decided to give us some money. So I went, my brethren, I think it was like 19,000 they gave me. And I went to Popular and I had 18,000 I owe them. I said, listen, I need to pay off this loan right away. From a youth, I just fear the thing that they call so I paid him off right away. I didn't owe anything. But here's the point, brethren. We must be very careful when we get into death.
Yeah.
Very careful. Okay, the bell is... Okay.
Yes,
go ahead.
I want to just say here,
go ahead.
Since we're pressing for time, being pressed for time here, we're coming down there. You see, Tuesday section, I want you to keep that in mind.
Mm-hmm.
There are folk here who may be privy to what we are saying here because of study this week. But there are others who are here who may be in debt at this moment.
That's correct.
How do you get out of it?
Quickly, tell us.
And that's Tuesday's section that I wanted to keep in mind.
Mm.
Very briefly, I want to say here, according to what we are instructed, get a list of all your debts.
Mm-hmm.
Make a list of them. Start with the bigger ones, the biggest one. And come right down.
Right.
And then you pay off the smaller one at the bottom, going back up. That's one thing to do. The other thing, don't get into any more debt.
And yes, Pastor.
Okay.
That's right.
Don't get into any more debt.
Go on.
And then, wait, if you should get a windfall is sudden funds that come into your hands.
We have back there.
Don't buy something with it because somebody sent you something you didn't expect. Put it towards
the debt.
Your debt.
That's right. That's right.
And number three, pray. Or number four, pray.
Okay.
And you'll get out of debt. Now, with regards to your brothers and sisters, not even them should make you fall into debt.
Yes.
You pray with them, talk with them. Help them. Give them something.
Right.
Don't co-sign for them. Eh?
All right. That's right. That's right. Let's have...
Am I too hard?
No, you're at the point. We have a hand back there.
Okay, somebody behind there.
Yeah, the snare about a credit card is sometimes you might say, well, okay, I'm going to pay early. I'm going to pay, on time, every time you're supposed to make the payment. But then you didn't read the fine prints and them good. When you have to pay for your house rent, or your mortgage, you might be a little late. In the fine writings, right? If you pay like your rent late, the increase in your credit card, the interest, because anything else that you pay, they keep a track on that. Anything else that you pay besides your credit card and you pay late, the increase, increase your payment.
All right. Okay, while he's coming, Pastor Josiah, the lesson still, we live in a material world and we are material people.
Yes.
That's mean we must not let material or the material world govern us.
No.
At all.
We must manage properly.
Yes.
I think the general idea is if you are in debt, especially with mortgage, try to get out of it as soon as you can.
Right.
Because though you have planned debt, as you say, Elder Josiah, you plan the thing.
Mm.
But bear in mind, it's not always predicated on your faithfulness in paying back, you know. It's also predicated on the greed of the lender as well.
Okay.
Because while you are planning to pay faithfully, he's also still planning how he could get it from you.
Yes.
Because I know just some years ago that Scotia Bank sold all its mortgages on Orfit in New Jersey.
Uh-huh.
And so now there's a new lender out there now, though you were with Scotia Bank.
Uh-huh.
But now they sold it to in New Jersey to another bank out there.
Yeah.
And they have new policies.
Uh-huh.
So now all the plans that you had, that is now changed.
Yeah.
And also the lenders have a tendency to find ways to create a hardship for you that you cannot pay so they can redeem that, you know.
Yes, yeah. And more.
So the whole idea is to try to get out of the debt as soon as possible.
Yes.
Because we're in a debt society. We live in it.
Amen.
You cannot get through. If you're going to build a house and have to wait 20 years, by the time that house finishes, you're done.
Yes.
So you may have to go get a mortgage.
Yeah.
But you must plan to get out as soon as you can.
Yes.
And be prudent about it.
Okay. And Brother Brown, you were saying about release.
Yes.
Keep in mind that we are not living in the ideal world. And in God's, in the Bible times, they had this plan for the release.
Right.
But that obtained within the Christian community.
Right. Correct.
Are you following me?
Yes.
So that after 7 years, and by the way, even then, even back there, the 7 years was a long time for the lenders, you know. And they give you that 7 years, that long time, in their interest.
Right.
Because they didn't want to forgive you.
Right.
They didn't want to forgive the people back there of the debt. And so they gave you 7 years. But they said, don't forget your brother, your family member.
Mm.
If you're lending them, don't long for them to extend it for 7 years.
No.
But if 7 years runs over, you are forgiven.
Oh, okay.
That was a Christian community. But we are not living in a Christian community per se. So keep in mind, brothers and sisters, the Bible is here to guide you as Christians. If you don't know how to deal with these situations, ask somebody who knows that you can sleep at night. When you have worries and you can't sleep, you're in trouble, you know.
Yes. Sister Daniel, make it short, please. Okay, Sister Lionel.
Yes, it's going to be very short. Uh-huh. Okay, so we are not supposed to co-sign for someone.
No,
you should not
but
be
we can lend someone money.
It's best That's, to give.
Is that what we're saying?
It's best to give.
With caution.
Okay.
No.
We can lend someone money.
You can, but
you
with caution.
With caution.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm lending cautiously.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Should I charge interest?
Not to a Christian, a fellow Christian.
Not
the Bible is clear
to your
that.
Brother. Not to your brother.
Not to your brother. And so, Pastor Jesse, you said something.
All right, let them settle down a bit. You see, we know that you have ideas, but just settle down that you can hear each other's comments because we are all here to learn.
But yes, Pastor Jesse.
Yes,
you said something to say about plan borrowing.
Plan debt,
Plan debt,
yes.
So hear me, Pastor Josiah. As a Christian, when we go to borrow money, we must plan that the tithe and offering is in there too, you know.
In there.
What we borrowing? How are we going to pay it back? Okay, let me restate that. Let me restate that. When you go to the bank, they ask you if you have any debt. Yes. Bear in mind. Wait, brethren. I may have crossed it over a little bit. But listen. bear in mind that you must plan that you also have your tithe and offering to pay. Isn't
from,
that clear?
From the borrowed
no,
money?
No, that's part of your money. You have when you're planning, that must be in the planning.
That's part of your expenditures as well.
Right, but let me finish. It must be in the planning. Because notice, when we get ourselves in trouble, the first thing that goes is God. Stop paying time. So that must be planned in the borrowing. Is it clear?
I did not pick up the paying back.
It must be there. Because you can't pay all this thing and come next week and say, well, I don't have
I
the time for
that.
You understand what I'm saying? Are we clear?
No.
We're not clear?
I did not pick up that in the lesson.
You must put that you have to pay that.
All right. I understand what Elder Brong just said. Elder Brong is saying when you're planning, you know you have to pay back.
Yes.
So your tithe must already be secured.
In the planning.
In the planning. In other words, that's I have my light bill to pay.
Exactly.
I have my food bill. I have my tithes and my offerings. So those are my expenses.
It must be in the planning.
Right. But there is something that somebody shared with me real quick. I only have only 30 seconds, and I know this is going to be a little bit confusing, but here's what someone told me. He said, Ravaria, when you pay off all your bills, your mortgage is done, everything is free and clear, bear in mind, you're also open that if anything happens, the first thing they do is to check out and see if all your stuff is clear. If you have no mortgage, your house is clear, they're going to sue you for that house. There's no lien on it. They go right after it.
Right.
That's also another dynamic as well. That's out there. Your business is free and clear. You don't own any money. Somebody stomped their toe in your yard.
Oh.
They're going to sue you, and they're going to try to get your house.
Oh, yes.
Well, there's no lien on the house.
If they're damaged on your property, yes.
That's right. So the first thing they do, they investigate you.
Okay.
Your house is paid for. They're going to sue you and go after that house.
Right.
So he said, Ravaria, keep something against it, a little something, so there's a lien against it.
All right.
So it is secured.
I am sorry we don't have time to speak about the economy, just how you economize to help you to live above being in debt, how to economize. Ellen White says, if you have to eat more porridge and bread, do it and stay out of debt. And then my last comment here, Brother Brown, you have the last say. I will pray afterwards. Last comment here. You see that little book, Counsel and Stewardship?
Yeah.
I would recommend, but Pastor Daniel, you can support me on that. I would recommend you find one. Buy it. Study it. It will save you a lot of problems. Counsels on Stewardship by Ellen G. White.
Well, our time is up,
yes.
And my last comment is this. Brethren, plan everything. If you even have to fast and pray before you borrow, plan that God is there. Make sure that we put him first.
Amen.
Last point.
Amen.
In all our borrowing, we must also help the poor. Hello?
Yes.
We must help the poor. Whatever we have in a packet, help the poor. Because there's a text that I can never understand. Well, I've come closer. Proverbs 17:16. When you give to the poor, you lend to God. How can you lend God anything when he owns everything? Think of it, Pastor Josiah.
Let us pray. Dear God, we have just touched upon this very important topic of debt, its reduction, how we get into it, how we can live above it. I pray that you remember each one here, Father. You want us to owe no man anything but love. You want us, Father, to remember that you own everything and that you can do so much for us. If we are even up to our necks, over our heads in debt, you can help us to get out and stay out. I pray that you'll bless this discussion we have had and the studies that we have done this week and what we'll do going forward. And we thank you, O God, for paying our debts for us. And may we live in such a way that when you shall return, we'll be able to come to you with our debts being paid and forgiven. This is our prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Sister Esther, I am so happy to see you. Welcome back home. Just a few reminders.
You mean they put you there?
The bin for Queen Louise Home is in the back. Next Sabbath is going to be our last Sabbath. So please, if you're going to contribute, just remember next week is your last Sabbath. I have a confession. Sister Westby, when I realized that they're really going to take Pastor and Sister David, I went to God and I started to complain. It's not that we don't have Sister Brown. We have Sister Brown, and she's well capable and able. But I was just being a little bit in my feelings about the switch. And God chastised me saying that I was hoarding because of all the talent that we had here. And then all of a sudden, God sprung something on me. And it's like, oh, you feel you know better than me? And I'm like, no. But then this family moved here. This is Ina Westby, and this is her husband, Jamal Westby. You're going to be hearing from him today for the first time. And they were a little reluctant because of the newness and stuff like that. But I pray God that God shows us that even though we think we have a plan, God has planned way before us. In closing, rather than being ignorant and having greed, God wants to teach us his wisdom and how to depend upon him. Rather than having unforeseen circumstances, we can also prepare by having savings. There are so many different things that God wants to teach us, and sometimes we tend to not think about the fact that God is really in control. Sometimes we feel that we're doing this all on our own, but when we really have turned our lives into God, God just really wants to show up and show out to tell us that he has everything in his control and that he is working things out for our good. Before I move on, if anybody has Dr. Henry's telephone number, I'd really like to get it. Dr. Henry is in Clive's Sabbath School class, and since Sister David is not here, we're going to need his telephone number to pass on the care coordinating. Okay, amen. I hope all the care coordinators, just a plug, just making sure all the care coordinators are doing their job to make sure that when you do not see your members in your class, you have that responsibility of calling to make sure everything is okay so that they would know that we missed you in Sabbath school. Amen? At this time, I want to teach you a song. This Sabbath school lesson was free from bondage. And as it is Black History Month, we were freed from slavery. And God wants to free us from being in debt. Well, you know, to just prep us today for worship. Prep. Did I say prep? I want to teach us a song called Nara. Nara means take my thanksgiving. And my children are all excited. That's why I was so torn today, because I really wanted to teach y'all this African song to help us not pay the debt, because we can never pay our debt. Who paid our debt? Jesus paid our debt. And this morning, I want to prep us in asking God to take our thanksgiving, that he has done so much for us. We really can't pay him back for what he has done for us. For he has died. He died on a cross and gave us his blood to cover all our sins. And I want to remind us about that this morning so that we can praise him and give him all the glory that he is due. Now, your part. As I told you what Nara means, it's Nara, Kelemo. We're only going to do one verse and the chorus, and that's it. Okay? Just because of time. And I know the time is of the essence, but we really wanted to. No. Jamal and the band is going to accompany us. Jedidah and Simone, quickly. We only have like 1 minute. So we're going to go straight in. I was going to have y'all join us, but I don't think that's going to be possible. So we're going to want to do one of the chorus and What Shall I Render? Okay?
Amen. Come on, let's say amen one more time. I want to thank Sister Brown in leading out today for our Sabbath school, and Pastor Josiah along with Brother Brown in leading in our discussion today. Just have a few announcements that I'd like to share with you. First of all, I'm going to ask all those who are part of the board, all board members, would you please come to the back of the platform immediately, all board members. We are asking you to do so right now. And also, we want to take the time to welcome Sister Daniel back home. Praise the Lord. Pastor Daniel, you're looking bright and sharp. They're looking as if the sun can outshine you today. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And I must say, I feel the same way. So, welcome back home, Sister Daniel. Also want to remind each one of us that we have, that in-gathering starts today, amen? We are launching our in-gathering today. We do have letters and cards available. So if you like to get one, you can either go to the Sabbath school teacher or the Sabbath school superintendent to be able to get a card or a letter. We also have donation letters for those who might want to contribute to the edifice that we are building right across the way, right in front of us. So again, if you would like to get those donation letters, you can go to Sister Lydia Defoe, and she will provide those for you. Amen? Do you want to see the church finish? Oh, wait. I only heard one person. Do we want to see the church finish? Let me try that one more time. Do we want to see the church finish? Yes. Let us work together in that regard. What do you say? Amen? Also, just want to remind us that tomorrow will be the funeral service for Brother Leonosio Schmidt. The viewing will be at 9, and the service will be at 10 at the Christiansted Seventh-day Adventist Temple. Now, considering that we do have a first-day church that will be worshiping around the same time, we're going to be using the Christiansted government parking lot. If the parking lot for the church is filled, we encourage us to park at the Christiansted government parking lot, and then we'll have a shuttle to take you from there to the church. All right, so please keep that in mind. And also, today is a day of celebration, because at the end of the service, we'll be having a baptism. Let me try that one more time. At the end of the day, we'll be having a baptism to the honor and glory of God. Amen. And so I encourage each one of us to be a part of that experience. We're going to be leaving here immediately after the service to go to the Lagoon Beach. And there we'll perform the rite of baptism. So may God bless you as we continue to worship the Lord together.
You would bless this offering so that we can hasten your coming. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen.
Say a pleasant good morning to everyone. After what would one call a... After what one would call a energizer bunny week or a go, 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 go week, we look forward to coming to church where we can rest in the Lord, where we can worship Him and be revived and be refreshed. I know I look forward to it every week. To worship. Even though I would not be here physically, I make sure that I do worship Him come Sabbath morning. And I just want to say a warm welcome to my brothers and my sisters who are here physically and to those who are online. Now, I know sometimes we have visitors among our midst. If you are here with us presently, I'm just going to ask that you wave your hand wherever you are. I understand that they have something special to give you today. So if you are here, you don't have to stand up. Just wave your hands and they will see you and they will be able to give you that little token that they have for you. And I'm seeing some hands waving on my right. So if you are seeing them, you can give them what we have to give them. So my dear brothers and sisters, for those of you who are here and for those of you online, let's worship the Lord or God our Savior in truth and in spirit. And I pray most of all that when you leave here, we will be revived and we will be refreshed. Welcome to church this morning.
Seventh-day Adventist Church, we welcome you with open arms of love. please join us as we continue by singing Watchmen, Blow the Gospel Trumpet.
Our scripture reading will be taken from Matthew chapter 28, verse 19 and 20. I will read in your hearing. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Here ends the reading of the Word of God.
This is the part of our service where we pray, we bow our heads, and we lift our hearts to heaven. Let us all bow our heads and lift our hearts heavenward. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Dear God, we want to be a part of your kingdom that will come. This is why we are here today in person, and we are online, because we want to be a part of your kingdom. Forgive us this day, as we forgive others that trespass against us. With these sentiments, we forgive our parents that have done things against us. We forgive our children that have done things against us. We forgive our partners, our husbands, our wives that have done things against us. We forgive those who dislike us that has done things against us. Because we know that if you forgive us of our sins, we are responsible to forgive others of mistakes they have done against us. So we pray and we ask that you may forgive us this day as we forgive them that trespass against us. Dear God, you said you will provide us our daily bread. And you have. You have given us strength that we could have gone to work and earn a living to provide our daily bread. Some of us did not work, but you still provide our daily bread, and we thank you for that. Dear God, we acknowledge that we are sinners and we do not have anything good to bring to you, just to Jesus, who is the one that says if we confess our sins, he will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Dear God, there are individuals who are online and who are in here who have issues with health, issues with family, issues with finances. But we know that you are a God who said in your words, a father will not give a son a stone when he asks for bread, and a father will not give a son a serpent if he asks for fish. You are better than any earthly father that we have. So we know that we don't have to ask, but you will give us everything according to the riches of your goodness and your blessing towards us. We ask you that you may touch the individuals who are sick. There are several individuals who are sick. They are listed in the bulletin. You know, we don't have to call their names because you know, we know that you see those names. You not only see those names, but you see other names that are not on this prayer list. And we are claiming it and we are asking it in the precious name of Jesus that you may do for those sick individuals more than they can think or ask or wonder about. You said you are the balm in Gilead. You are the great physician. So we claim this promise. Dear God, you know there are things that we want and we need and we request. But we leave everything in your hands because you say that you will work everything out for our good. Sometimes we pray, but we do not know what is our good. This is why we are trusting you. We are trusting you to work all things out in accordance to your will. And give us the faith that we will follow you, even though we can't trust you, even though we cannot see. Help us to always walk in this assurance that you have our best interests at heart. This is our prayer. And we ask it not because we are good. We ask it in Jesus' name, who is good and who saved us and who died to save us and died to redeem us. This is our prayer. Let the church say amen and amen.
I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, reach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. And you made a way across the deep divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid a debt I owe. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, you have made me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glory. Laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death have no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, you have washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glory. There is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood. The blood that calls us sons and daughters. We are ransomed by a puddle through the blood. Everybody say, glory to His name.
It is the psalmist who said in Psalm 116, "What shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I shall take up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord." The greatest benefit that God has given to the human race is the gift of salvation through his son, Jesus Christ. And so that it is a giving and receiving. In 1 John 4:8, the Bible says, "He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love." And it is as if the prophet Malachi put a spin on the whole thing. In Malachi chapter 3, verse 8, he says, "Will a man rob God?" And the people ask, "Where, in what have we robbed thee?" And Malachi, of course, God speaking to the prophet Malachi said, "In tithe and in offering." In this whole thing of giving and receiving, the prophet says, "Bring all the tithe into the storehouse, and I will bless you. I will open the windows of heaven that there shall not be room enough to receive it." It's a matter of giving and receiving. I pray this morning that as you return your tithe and your offering, that it will deepen your relationship with God, and you would have, of course, make your contribution to preaching the gospel around the world. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are just so thankful for the opportunity where we can give a portion of what you've given. We pray that you'll bless it and use it to enhance your work in this part, in the Virgin Islands and throughout the world. Hear this prayer now, we ask, for Christ's sake.
It is coming from my heart, praise and thanks unto you, Lord. All the things that you have done, I'm grateful for your love. I give you the praise.
It is coming from my heart.
It is coming from my heart.
Praise and thanks unto you, Lord.
Praise and thanks unto you, Lord.
For all the things you've done.
All the things that you have done, I'm grateful for your love. I give you the praise.
I am counting my blessings.
I'm counting my blessings. I just can't keep it to myself. When I thought that he had done too much, oh, Jesus did it again.
I am counting my blessings.
I'm counting my blessings. I just can't keep it to myself. When I thought that he had done too much, oh, Jesus did it again.
It is coming from my
my heart.
Praise and thanks unto you,
praise
Lord.
Praise and thanks unto you, Lord.
For everything you've done.
All the things that you have done.
I'm
grateful for your love. I give you the praise.
It is coming from my heart.
It is coming from my heart. Praise and thanks unto you, Lord. All the things that you have done. I'm grateful for your love. I give you the praise.
I am counting my blessings.
I'm counting my blessings. I just can't keep it to myself. When I thought that he had done too much, oh, Jesus did it again.
I am counting my blessings.
I'm counting my blessings. I just can't keep it to myself. Jesus did it again.
I can't tell it enough.
when the praises go up, the blessings
go down.
Have you been blessed?
Yeah.
Our God is such an awesome God. And it's just a privilege for us to be here this morning to worship Him in spirit and in truth. The song says, how great is our God. Is your God great? My God is an awesome God. So lift our voices as we sing, how great. The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth, every one of us, rejoice.
The splendor of a king.
The splendor of a king.
He's clothed.
called upon the name of the Lord and he's come through for you? Let me see the show of hands. In his name there is power, amen. In his name there is healing. There is a simple song that just says, every time I call on the name of Jesus, something happens. He has so many names. Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah what? Jireh. He's an amazing God. So let's sing this simple song. We'll sing it one time through, and then you can join us. It's new for us, and I'm sure it's new for you. If it's not, sing along with us every time.
Every time I call on the name of Jesus,
every time I call on the name of Jesus, something.
I call on the name of Jesus, he will come through for me. For my God is awesome. He can move mountains. In the moments when I'm in that valley, he just picks me up out of that miry clay, cleans me off, dusts me off, and said, child, go on in Jesus' name. For my God is awesome. Amen? Amen? Hallelujah. He is an awesome, an amazing, a wonderful, a faithful, faithful God.
My God is awesome. He can move mountains, keep me in the valley, hide me from the rain. My God is awesome. Heals me when I'm broken, strength where I've been weakened. Forever he will reign.
Let's sing that again. My God is awesome.
My God is awesome. He can move.
God, for you are Alpha and you are Omega. We worship you, O God.
Thank you.
Yes. Do we believe that God is worthy to be praised? Let me try that again. Do we really believe that God is worthy to be praised? I want to thank the praise team for their ministry and music. Before I share our message for this morning, we just have a short testimony from Brother McGlure that he'd like to share with the church. So I'm just going to allow him the privilege of being able to share how God has been good to him.
Praise God this morning. When I heard the praise team sang, "God is our protector," I feel good. This week on Thursday, I was off. Anytime I'm off, I go fishing. That's my hobby. And I left. I fished the morning. Then I came back home. I put my food on fire. Everything was on the stove. I said, "Well, I'm going to leave at 12. I put off the stove. I left. When it was 6, after 6, I came back. I take a little scent. That's 6 long hours. When I watch, I said, "My God, what a miracle." The stove was on. The food just dry up. And did not even pot that God burned. So, you know, I cannot dog give God thanks. That's a miracle. 6 hours. 6 good hours. Thanks God for that.
Amen. Amen. God is indeed our protector and our provider. What do you say? To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Today, our message is simply marching orders. Marching orders. Before we go, gracious Lord, we acknowledge you as God. There is none like you. And even as we delve into your word, we pray that a clearer and brighter vision will be made for us in terms of who you are. This we ask in Christ's name. Amen. Now today is the first Sabbath of the month, and it has been mandated from the wider organization that for the first Sabbath of every month, the focus should be the mission of the church. Now, does everybody know what the mission of the church is? The Great Commission is our mandate. Our marching orders. Now, for those who do not know what the Great Commission is, I would like for us to cite it together. It is found in Matthew chapter 28. I'm going to read verses 19 and 20. Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. What does the Bible say, everybody? It says what? "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and unto the end of the world. Amen." Now, although the first Sabbath has been set aside by the wider organization to focus on evangelism, our mission, our mandate, is not one that was directed by the General Conference President or Pastor Heskett Matthew, the personal ministries director of the conference. Our marching orders come from Jesus. In fact, shallow observance of this text clearly reveals that it is not a command that is restricted to the first Sabbath of the month, seeing that the only time limit Jesus placed on this command extends to the end of the world, indicates that our mission is one that is constant. It is supposed to imbibe who we are, infiltrating every aspect of our lives. To put it simply, we are supposed to be consumed, yes, preoccupied, with sharing the good news of the gospel. Is the preacher making sense this morning? Now, before anybody presumes that these directives issued by Jesus only apply to spiritual leaders, I want us to take note of whom our Lord was talking to. He was not only conversing with the 12 disciples, but 120 of his followers, men and women, just like you and me, the majority of whom we have no idea of. Thus, we can reason that Jesus, in his proclamation, was addressing all of his followers, and by extension, every one of us who are living in the 21st century. Yes, we are all missionaries, evangelists, Brother Reverier, for Jesus. Now, if we don't see ourselves in this fashion, I pray that this message will be a wake-up call to each one of us. But what I love about the Great Commission, what I love about it the most, is the fact that Christ promises that he will be with us. He declared, "And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." In other words, he who hath begun a good work in you will complete it. Yes, we are not orphans. We are guaranteed success because Jesus promises to be there to strengthen and to guide us. Oh, somebody ought to say amen. Now, this is especially comforting when we consider who our arch enemy is. You see, we are no match for the devil. But in the same breath, he is no match for my Jesus. In other words, we can move forward with the assurance that we have already won the proverbial battle with the enemy of our souls because Jesus is on our side. But to go beyond that, we cannot compete with the human propensity to sin or the faulty trends of society. The only reason we can have confidence that we can conquer these societal norms, yes, these social influences, is based on the fact that we have the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords leading the charge. And so, if there is any doubt in regard to whether we can defeat the enemy, or if we are qualified, or we have the prerequisite skills to share the gospel, there is no need to worry. Come on now. Because Jesus, yes, our God, has already promised. Yes, Jesus is all that we need to be successful in completing the mission. And I can get excited about this, because I'm enamored by the fact that I get to work alongside with heavenly agencies and see God work miracles in and through me. Come on now. Yes, you see, there is nothing like, or there is no greater feeling than seeing God use sinful human beings like you and me to bring another sinner to him. Come on now. Do I have a witness in the church? I'm saying, friends, there is nothing greater than seeing the miracle of salvation that changes a drunkard to one that is sober, a liar into an honest man, a womanizer to one that is faithful. I'm saying, friends, he is still a miracle working God. And this brings me to the crux of the message today. We need Jesus. What did I say? Come on now, say it to me. What did I say, everybody? Yes, we need Jesus. Now, there are various means and methods that one can engage in when it comes to evangelism, such as evangelistic campaigns, small groups, one-on-one Bible study. Each can be put in one of two categories: personal or public evangelism. However, no matter the method, if Jesus is not in it, it amounts to nothing. In fact, you may not know this, but my emphasis for my master's degree from Andrews University was in evangelism. But if I implement all that I learned when I was in school and have not Jesus, I might as well have spent all my money on something else. And so when it comes to sharing the gospel, it is imperative that one has an encounter with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now, if we were to have a barometer to determine if you belong to Christ, Jesus, in his last moments on earth, distinguished only one characteristic. How much? How much? One characteristic that serves as a strong indicator that we are connected to him, that we are truly his servants. And I want us to take a look at it now. We're going to turn in our Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 13, and we're going to read verse 35. John, chapter 13, and we're going to read verse 35. I want us to read this scripture together now. I want the whole of Peter's rest to hear us reading God's word. What's the Bible say, everybody? Okay, now it doesn't sound like everybody. So I want to make sure that we have it. That's the Gospel of John, chapter 13, and we're reading verse 35. John 13, verse 35. What's the Bible say, everybody? Shall all men know that what? Ye are my disciples, if you what? If you have what? Love to? Yes. These words were uttered in the closing scenes of Jesus' ministry here on earth. Our master is meeting with his disciples exclusively now. And in this solemn scene, the cross with the reality of death is before him. A flood of emotions seem to overtake him. In fact, at one point, John notices that he is troubled by the thought of being betrayed by one of his own. Yet though troubled, in his eyes, one can see calm determination. And with words flowing steadfastly, revealing his hopeful disposition, Jesus is letting his disciples know in his final words of admonition just before his death what is the most important attribute that is needed to be considered his. The key factor in fulfilling his marching orders. Love for one another. What is it, everybody? You see, there's only one parameter that God indicates that we have a relationship with him, and that is love. It is not speaking in tongues. It is not a theological degree. It is not having the title prayer warrior or church board member. It is love. Paul called it the fruit of the Spirit. In fact, I would go a step further. One's association with the church is not the barometer that Jesus used. The disciples were around Jesus for 3.5 years. But being around Jesus wasn't an indicator that they were connected to Christ. We need not look further than Judas to understand this fact. And I would submit to you this morning that one can be around spiritual settings and still be a Judas. You can be the cream of the crop and still be a Judas. You can wax eloquently and still be a betrayer of the master you claim to follow. You can be a church officer like Judas. Yes, serving on the church board and still be at any other faith. You see, no one was considered more qualified, even amongst the disciples, to be a disciple of Christ than Judas. I'm saying, friends, today, one's connection with the church is not an indicator that an individual is connected to the master. And to be truthful, there are some who feel it is what we do that demonstrates the fact that God reigns in our hearts. But I want us to pay keen attention to what Paul has to say. You see, Paul painted this picture beautifully in what most call the love chapter. He says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, I have not charity. I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. And what frequently pains my heart is the fact that love for one another is often not a reality in the church. But I'm not talking about this church. I'm still getting to know this church. Are you with me? But I remember when I first got into ministry, Pastor Brown, when people found out that this young man in his early 20s was a pastor, the first thing they used to say is, you're too young to be a pastor. And then the follow-up question was, which church? And each time, almost without fail, when I mentioned the name Seventh-day Adventist, there was an adverse reaction.
And I was flummoxed at how the name of the church was sullied because of some member who did not demonstrate what it meant to love. Yes, somebody who decided, I will never be a member of that church because of sister so-and-so's or brother so-and-so's on Christ-like behavior. And if you're wondering, it's not only in the Bible that this issue is addressed, but even Sister White had these words to say. I'm going to cite them. She says, it is the greatest and most fatal deception to suppose that a man can have faith unto eternal life without possessing Christ-like love for his brethren. The powers of darkness stand a poor chance against believers. Let me
start that again, because I want to make sure I get it clear.
The powers of darkness stand a poor chance against believers who love one another as Christ has loved them, who refuse to create alienation and strife, who stand together, who do what? Who are kind, courteous, and tender-hearted, cherishing the faith that works by love and purifies the soul. End of quote. So although love is what is most important in Jesus' book, it tends to be what is most disregarded by our daily practice, where we refuse to talk to one another for years, just feeling content to say good morning or good afternoon, or not be associated with one another. Does that reveal our love for our brothers and our sisters? When we decide to tear each other down, yes, gossip about one another, does that reveal the love that Christ is calling us to? If I can, 1 John 4, verses 20 and 21, the Bible says, if a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? And this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also. To put it simply, if you don't love your brother or your sister, you are lost. Period. But I praise God that Jesus gave us the ultimate example. Amen? If we should ever wonder what it means to have love for your brother or your sisters, consider Jesus. In fact, I want us to go back now to John chapter 13. We're going to look at verse 31 of John chapter 13. It tells us, therefore, when he was gone out, Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. Now, when Jesus references being glorified by the revere, is he referring to being famous or being on Forbes' list of the wealthiest individuals in the world? No. Jesus wasn't talking about being given a crown or putting on a heavenly robe in reference to him being glorified. He was talking about the cross. He was talking about what, brothers and sisters? He was pointing to the ultimate demonstration of love, which was laying down his life for each and every one of us. For Christ giving his life for you and for me is glorious. And not only just giving his life, but for individuals who despised and rejected him. So the Great Commission is to go and teach the everlasting gospel. But my prayer is that our determination will not only to be to spread the good news of the gospel, but to press forward together as brothers and sisters in love. You see, next year, we are going to be engaged in an evangelistic campaign, whether on an island level or a district level. And we're going to be working towards it. Come on now. And my prayer is that the membership here in the Peter's Rest Church is not divided and torn apart with strife, but is united as one. Because though it is good as a church for us to plan and to strategize, if we in any way harbor animosity, jealousy, or hatred for one another, all our planning would have been in vain. See, those who we seek to minister to will be able to see through our facade, resulting with walls being put up, making it difficult for them to receive the good news of salvation. And so my call is simple. Let's lay aside every burden and the sin that so easily besets us. And let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Let us move forward, conquering unto conquer as one body in Christ Jesus. Is this your desire? Let me just see you raise your hand. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let me be honest with you, brothers and sisters. I know that in every congregation, there might be somebody who rubs you the wrong way. Am I speaking the truth? And for some of us, I don't know, there might be somebody here who has been harboring some feelings of animosity towards somebody for the past month. 6 months, probably even 5 years or more. My encouragement to each one of us is that if that's the case, before we leave here today, you find that individual and you make that right with them. Are you with me?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So let's make that determination in our heart. Because ultimately, if we don't have that love, guess what? We will not be saved. In fact, we will be the most people miserable. I'm not going to allow any brother or any sister to stop me from seeing my Jesus. Amen. So that's your determination. Why don't you just stand with me even as we pray? Praise God. Praise God. Pastor Daniel, would you mind praying for us? Would you mind praying for us?
Shall we pray? Gracious God, our loving Heavenly Father, you came very, very close to us today through the ministry of the Word. The response in our heart today is, by God's grace, we want to be faithful. Faithful to you, first of all. And we want to know that the peace of God in our hearts will be registered among one another. that we can call each other brother. We can live at peace and in harmony with each other, so that the world will have a witness, as the Bible teaches, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one for another. We heard your voice today, Lord, and in response to the message presented to us, we stand to our feet with our heads bowed, indicating to God we are ready for the charge. We are ready to fulfill the mission of the church, the everlasting gospel to all the world, so that Jesus may come. The time is ripe. The signs of the times all around us are pointing to one fact. Jesus wants to come. Jesus will soon come. Grant, dear God, that we will play our part in these closing days of Earth's history, so that none of us will be found wanting, but we will be, by God's grace, have fulfilled God's will and plan for our lives, that we will hear the piercing words that will come to mortal ears. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Please accept our commitment today, Father. And if somebody under the voice of the message of the pastor today realizes that I have not been doing all that I need to do, I've been wandering away from God, and Lord, that person is desirous of coming home, may they come home, so that they too can be part of carrying this gospel, so that when Jesus comes, they too can hear the well done. This we ask with thanksgiving in the name of Jesus. Amen.
I ask us to be seated before the praise team comes on. I just want to praise the Lord that we have somebody who's going down into the watery grave for baptism today. Amen. And so we're going to invite Sister Kristen to come and join me here at the platform. Don't be shy. Somebody say amen. Praise the Lord. God is indeed good. Sister Kristen Francis, who has made a determination to give her heart to the Lord Jesus Christ by going down into the water grave of baptism. And so before she does so, we're just going to go through the baptismal vows. And as I go through each one, I'm going to ask you to answer in the affirmative. Now I see that you have your mask on. You want to make sure that everybody can hear you. So I ask you to be move it. There we go. And make sure you answer loudly so that everybody can hear you. All right? They believe there is one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, a unity of three core eternal persons. Praise the Lord. Do you accept the death of Jesus Christ on Calvary as the atoning sacrifice for your sins? I believe by God's grace, through faith in his shed blood, you're saved from sin and its penalty. Do you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior?
believing that God in Christ has forgiven your sins and given you a new heart? And do you renounce the sinful ways of the world? Do you accept by faith the righteousness of Christ, your intercessor in the heavenly sanctuary, and accept his promise of transforming grace and power to live a loving, Christ-centered life in your home and before the world?
Yes.
Do you believe that the Bible is God's inspired word, the only rule of faith and practice for the Christian? Do you covenant or promise to spend time regularly in prayer and Bible study?
Yes.
Do you accept the Ten Commandments as a transcript of the character of God and a revelation of his will? Is it your purpose by the power of the indwelling Christ to keep this law, including the fourth commandment, which requires the observance of the seventh day of the week as the Sabbath of the Lord and the memorial of creation?
Yes.
Do you look forward to the soon coming of Jesus and the blessed hope when this mortal shall put on immortality? As you prepare to meet the Lord, will you witness to his loving salvation by using your talents in personal soul-winning endeavor to help others to be ready for his glorious appearing?
Yes.
Do you accept the biblical teaching of spiritual gifts? I believe that the gift of prophecy is one of the identifying marks of the remnant church.
Yes.
Do you believe in church organization? Is it your purpose to worship God and to support the church through your tithes and offerings and by your personal effort and influence?
Yes.
Do you believe that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit? And will you honor God by caring for it, avoiding the use of that which is harmful, and abstaining from all unclean foods, from the use, manufacture, or sale of alcoholic beverages, from the use, manufacture, or sale of tobacco in any of its forms for human consumption, and from the misuse of or trafficking in narcotics or other drugs? Do you know and understand the fundamental Bible principles as taught by the Seventh-day Adventist Church? Do you purpose by the grace of God to fulfill his will by ordering your life in harmony with these principles? Do you accept the New Testament teaching of baptism by immersion and desire to be so baptized as a public expression of faith in Christ and his forgiveness of your sins?
Yes.
Do you accept and believe that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is a remnant church of Bible prophecy, and that people of every nation, race, and language are invited and accepted into his fellowship? Do you desire to be a member of this local congregation of the World Church?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask you to turn around at this time. Don't be shy. It's okay. Good luck. Would somebody move that we accept Sister Kristen as a member of this church subject to her baptism? It's moved. Is there a second to that? All right. All in favor, please indicate by waving at me. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. All those who oppose, it is carried. Praise the Lord. We're going to have the baptism at Lagoon right after, immediately after the service. So we encourage us, as soon as we leave here, to join us at the Lagoon Beach.
Gracious to you, the Lord turn his Amen. It would be remiss for me not to recognize the miracle in that the Western family who've been part of some life from the West
Indian.
You have joined us at Peace Rest. And as Sister Ministry, so the husband is quite capable. And today is to the first thing. And the plane feeling is behind. See, God knows the history. And he takes care of things behind the scenes. We are grateful for the young man offering this prayer from Central to join us here. Chastity. And today, as a handsome young guy, beautiful. Very happy to have you all today with us.
Praise the Lord, because our God is an awesome God. So your church is dismissed, but we just found it fitting to sing this song again.
God,
the miracle
your hand
of baptism, someone is giving their life over to you.
Keep your hand upon.
Deliver us.
Deliver us.
Deliver us.
Deliver us.
Deliver us.